I had done rug restoration for about 13 years before I even hooked my first rug. And I was doing quilt and hook rug repair. I worked for Kate and Joel Kopp, who wrote a wonderful book. And the back of the book, they have kind of little diagrams of the process. And so I, well, that's not so tough. So I would patch the holes and then fix it with old stuff from other rugs that were too far gone to be repaired. And so I sort of learned it that way, but I didn't really make my own first rug from start to finish until my horse died as a memorial to him. And I then used t-shirts that I had worn while riding him that were too good to throw away. And I worked on monk's cloth, whereas all the rugs I had been repairing were on burlap, but I can see what happens to burlap. And so I just didn't want to use that. I wanted my rugs to last a little longer. There was one little tiny rug that I found that I just loved the look of. And so I copied it. And I have to say, I was so disappointed in the results. I thought the original was so much nicer. I was embarrassed that I had deigned to improve it. I don't even know if that was my intention, but to do it differently. And I thought, I'm not going to do that again. I really like coming up with my own ideas. And I tend to be more abstract in my designs, even though I'm a big fan of American folk art. I mean, they are kind of abstracted themselves, but I don't really deal with figurative work too much or representational things a few times, but I really like more abstract designs. And that pretty much means doing it myself. I'm always exploring mixing of things, combining things, just seeing if other things I'm interested in might have something to offer that I could bring into the work that I don't even know is available for it. I think people kind of, you know, if you do glass, you do glass. If metal, wood, fiber, that's where you are. And that if you can sometimes incorporate other aspects of the others, you can see where they can complement one another, or maybe just, you know, even wood graining might be a pattern design in rug hooking or something like that. So I don't know. It's fun when that happens. It's exciting. Yeah. I started working for America Hurrah Antiques when I moved to New York. I basically taught myself. I mean, I had always done handwork. I did beadwork. I did macrame in the 70s. I did craft shows with things that I had made. And I'd sewn clothing for myself and for a boutique when I was living in Minneapolis, Minnesota, before I moved to New York. So I was very comfortable with needle and thread. I was also an antiques dealer. It was probably in 1975 or so that I saw my first quilt. I mean, I'd seen them before, but they hadn't really registered much. And once I saw that, it was kind of, that was where I went. So I didn't learn from anything. I didn't take a class. Working for America Hurrah was a fabulous experience. They had everything just from amazing to kind of run-of-the-mill stuff, but mostly amazing stuff that I got to work on. So it was, and I love problem solving. And so the combination of seeing a problem, how is it done? How might I get it to work? What should I use to do that? What's the process to get that way so I don't end up doing too much and regret that or make a mistake and think, oh, I shouldn't have cut there. I should have cut over here. I really enjoy that process. And there were some jobs that it took me a while just before I even started. I just wanted to make sure that I wasn't going to work myself into too much of a corner. It's one thing if I do it on my own work, that's, I kind of enjoy working my way out of it and things always change into something I hadn't expected. But if I'm working on an antique piece, I don't want to end up getting creative about it. I want it to look as much as the way it did when it was originally done. I had started school, I mean, kind of age appropriate after high school. I went to college in Colorado and then back in Minnesota. I didn't know what I wanted to do. I just was very vague about stuff. And so I dropped out to go into antiques. And it wasn't until I got married in 2005 that I could then go back to school. And then I knew I wanted to be involved in making things. And so I was dealing with, my topic of study was American history through women's handmade textiles. I didn't want to say just textiles because that could be industrial. I wanted it to be handmade because that's where I really find my interest is the expression that is created when people make things by hand, however they make them, whether it's metal, glass, ceramics, or fiber. I find that fascinating. I have to say, when I started, because I didn't have anyone around me, I was using recycled things. I mean, that was what I saw in the old rugs, and that was pretty much what I had available to me. I don't do any dyeing. And then when I started going to rug hooking events, I went up to the Green Mountain Guild that used to be held at the Shelburne Museum in Vermont. And there were vendors and they were selling gorgeous wool. And so there was all this new wool. And then it seems people began to get more into recycled. I think people are getting much more adventuresome and incorporating recycled things, yarns, just odd, whatever they can kind of attach, they'll use. Sure, there are some who really like to maintain a certain kind of quality of wool and whatnot. For me, I don't care what the material is. If it gives the result that I want, then that's what I'm going to use. I'm not too fussy about whether it's all wool or not. I haven't been doing any restoration for quite a few years. It was pretty much straight hooked. And sometimes with very bulky, lumpy looking fabrics that were really quite awkward. And then of course you get the Grenfell rugs with their very thin nylon stockings, silk stockings, I should say. Those are probably the most difficult to restore. Most of them were from, I would say, the 1940s and earlier. And certainly you would see different materials being used. So rayons and stuff began to get incorporated in it. There were silk stockings. Old silk stockings are really difficult. They're easy to hook, but they are so difficult to repair if you need a needle and thread. And so much of the restoration required needle and thread to secure the area. And then if there was a hole, you had to fill it in, but you had to secure the area around it. Oh man, trying to get a needle through certain silk stockings was really difficult. 1800s, there would be sweaters, old socks, long underwear, heavy coat fabrics. It was a real mix. Whatever was there was used. Nothing, I think, was deemed unusable unless it was just physically unusable. Too ratty, too torn, too something. Keep them out of sun. Sunlight, well, even any bright light. And it's hard to do that. You want to enjoy it. You want to see it. You want to have it lit because it looks great. But it's going to take its toll. And there is very little you can do about that other than trying to keep it not in bright light. If you go away for a while, cover it, even just a sheet over the top of it will help. Also, the way you store it, if it's mounted and it can be stored flat and upright, if you're going to store them rolled, they should be rolled. They should be rolled around a tube of some sort so that they don't end up making folds. The worst thing to do is to fold them in quarters. I can't tell you how many rugs, you can always tell when the center of the rug is rotted out. It's just the burlap and the cracking and the pressure on it, especially when any hooked rug, if you try and fold it the wrong way, it's very stiff and you're stretching the backing. If you roll it with the loops out, and most people want to roll it the other way to protect it, you roll it with the loops out, the loops will expand and so you're keeping the backing non-stressed. Then roll it in clean fabric to cover over it. I wouldn't put it in plastic, but if you're worried, then I would store like a loose plastic over it if you're afraid something might drip on it. But you want air circulation. You never want to seal it up, other than for shipping for a short term. You never want air to be sealed in there. It would be nice to have it 50% humidity, but we don't really have that. But high extremes, you know, a basement and attic are not good places to put them, but sometimes that's all you have. You kind of do what you can. You roll it right side out and protect it from moisture and sunlight as best you can.
Thanks for watching my video. If you would like to see more, click the subscribe button. If you would like to support making these videos, you can donate via the button on the banner of my YouTube channel. You will also find my social media links there.